Good morning. At the outset, let me thank Professor Patre for giving me this opportunity and for being with you today. You have got very nice overview by Commander Vijay Singh. Indian Army, Navy, Air Force, DRDO is meant for them. And they are technologically their requirements. They are almost like cutthroat, most state of the art. And he has very nicely brought out the naval requirements, especially yours being an underwater workshop. You can gauge that the kind of technologies are required for services, Navy, and similar thing you will find for Army and Air Force. For next about 1.5 hours, I will be talking on this particular topic. This is not really very specifically related to underwater systems, but I will keep referencing to them. This is more a general topic, but I am sure at the end you will realize that it has applicability in underwater systems as well, such as submarines, torpedoes, and those autonomous underwater vehicles and so on. My background is on flight controls, that is on aircraft, missile, launch vehicles, satellites and those kind of things. So it is like a counter part of underwater vehicles. So let me start. I will start with some basics. As you know, feedback control is one of the most important areas in modern engineering systems. If you look at this, it is not a new terminology. The time spectrum of evolution of feedback control started almost like at least the example which we read in textbooks, the James Watt's flyby governor, dates almost like 1877 or so. That is on one hand. On the other hand, we have very sophisticated control systems in missiles. So these two blocks actually shows you the time spectrum. Although formally the theory of control engineering is there since maybe 1950 onwards, but actual control applications were there much earlier than that. Many of these terminologies you will be familiar. This is a typical composition. What we look at a feedback control system, we have a plant which we want to control. When I say control means, I want a particular output of that plant to behave in a desired manner. So it needs to be measured. The error between what we want and what exists is manipulated by controller, which is actually the central unit as far as this feedback control system is concerned. You may have actuator which will change the input to the plant. Various disturbances, uncertainties, measurement noise, unmodeled dynamics and all those things are present for this plant. What feedback does? The first, when we get introduced to control systems, we usually ignore what feedback does. Feedback has very fundamental properties. If you are dealing with a stable system, probably you may be able to get the desired response or desired behavior even by without using feedback. But when it comes to unstable system, feedback becomes mandatory. That is very fundamental property. Feedback has a capability, feedback has an ability to change the dynamics of the system synthetically. The plant remains same. Simple example which I am more familiar is with the fighter aircraft. Fighter aircraft as a system is unstable. If you allow the aircraft to fly on its own without the autopilot, it will crash in no time. But the feedback control system makes it one of the most wonderful, wonderfully functioning system, right? If you have seen the maneuvers, how the fighter aircraft does, it obeys the pilot's commands extremely fast in manner and very accurately. Changes system dynamics, that means an unstable system can be converted into a stable system synthetically, and also it can change the behavior of the system. As we know, we can change the response. Reduce sensitivity to uncertainty and disturbances. This is one fundamental characteristic of feedback. Open loop control systems, probably we may be able to operate, but it does not have immunity for change in parameters, disturbances. Feedback provides it. That is basic characteristic of feedback. We can use feedback intelligently to somehow linearize otherwise non-linear system. the area is known as feedback linearization. Smoothing and filtering and many such properties probably you can mention. I am stating this thing because I am going to talk to you about the uncertainties and disturbances. This is another example of an unstable system, right? This is like a inverted pendulum. In our control text we study what is known as inverted pendulum or stick hold, like something like this. If you hold this pendulum like this, normal pendulum, this equilibrium of this pendulum is a stable one. Stable in the sense that if I disturb it from its equilibrium, it has a tendency to come back to its original equilibrium without any extra efforts on your part, right? So we call this system or this equilibrium as a stable equilibrium. If I invert it by 180 degrees, now this is its unstable equilibrium. It's an equilibrium which is unstable in the sense that a small disturbance to this is going to just fall, you know, free fall object. A launch vehicle, ICBM class of missiles, they are actually inverted pendulums, inverted sticks. You will see that when this vehicle is launched, a small disturbance, wind disturbance will make it to actually, you know, crash, but that does not happen. The feedback control takes care, you know, you do not have a long stick here, but you can experience, many people, you know, they hold their stick on their fingertip and that they do it by, you know, maneuvering their fingers. Essentially, you are providing a control action and ensuring that the stick remains vertical. Precisely that physics is imitated in actual missiles or launch vehicles by using what is known as a thrust vector control. A thruster will be continuously moving something like this, just imitating the physics of your finger. This is possible because of feedback. Without feedback, flying such kind of vehicles is just impossible. A good design should ensure stability, performance and robustness. Robustness in stability and robustness in performance. This is in robustness is related to, you know, uncertainties, disturbances, measurement inaccuracies, unmodeled dynamics and many such things which you do not cater while designing. I consider a plant assuming that represents the physics of the plant reasonably accurately. We design a controller and then we expect that controller to behave in satisfactory manner when put in practice. That will happen provided the plant which you have taken, the mathematical model which you have taken really represent the physical system. And that rarely happens, especially for underwater vehicles or missiles. We really cannot mathematically model those systems very accurately. So when you use a particular mathematical model, you have to cater for the various uncertainties and disturbances which that vehicle is supposed to experience in its flight. We also are familiar in classical control tells us that more stable systems offer poorer performance. Stability and performance are inversely proportional to each other. If you look at the classical Bode plot, open loop Bode plots, if you increase the gain crossover frequency, the closed loop bandwidth increases, but at the cost of stability margins, right? As the gain crossover frequency goes towards right, the stability margin starts reducing, right? So, and you are making the system faster, bandwidth is increased, but at the cost of sacrificing the stability, okay? Classical control offers you, classically designed feedback system offers you immunity from sensitivity, uncertainty, disturbances, but to do that, I will show you simple examples. You have to sacrifice somewhere. To compensate this without sacrificing those requirements, is there any other approach? And that is where the area known as control design based on disturbance estimation comes into picture. Methods to do with uncertainty and disturbances. As you will agree with me that probably if you are talking about an electrical motor, the dynamics is reasonably well known. The parameters of the motor are reasonably known and not much uncertainty you can expect. But when you talk about underwater vehicle, when you talk about missile, aircraft, this kind of vehicles, interplanetary vehicles, a vehicle which goes to Mars for example, okay, their behavior is dependent upon not only what is there inside, their overall behavior depends on what is outside as well. For example, atmospheric conditions, the conditions in water, the sea currents, underwater currents what we call, the sea state, wind profile on that particular day at sea, all those things decide the hydrodynamic parameters and aerodynamic parameters for these vehicles and they are not known a priori. For example, if you go to Mars, the atmospheric properties can change as much as 60 to 100%. So if you design a particular controller assuming that nominal atmospheric conditions, your controller is not likely to function, because that was under the assumption that there are no uncertainties. Okay. So we need to cater for uncertainties and disturbances. Typically, we have different approaches. Classical high loop gain, as I told you, and I will show you with simple example. If you want to reduce the effect of disturbance on output, one standard approach is that to increase the loop gain. So when you increase loop gain, high gain control, what we call, okay. When you increase the loop gain, the gain plot of the Bode plot goes up, and so the, you know, gain crossover frequency shifts to a right. When that happens, and since increase in loop gain does not alter the phase plot, essentially you are reducing the stability margins. Okay. High loop gain, when if you are employing in classical control, you are doing it at the cost of stability, robustness. Integral control actions, people have used integral controller, you are familiar with PID sort of controllers, right? Integral controller has proven very useful for disturbances which are constant in nature. For time varying disturbances, for fast varying disturbances, integral controller does not offer a solution. Okay. This point also I will show you with simple example. Another category of control design techniques are robust designs characterizing the uncertainty and disturbances. You will study, by especially those of you who are doing a PhD and faculty members, they will agree with me that we frequently come across a word called robust control. Somehow I don't digest that word, because classical control system themselves are robust in the sense that they offer immunity from uncertainties and disturbances. Okay. But anyway, there are specific theory, H infinity control, for example, right? Sliding mode control. Okay, they are supposed to be robust because they can tolerate higher uncertainties and disturbances. Those techniques require some characterization of disturbances and uncertainties. For example, deterministic, polynomial, bounded, stochastic. For example, just to give an example, if you are using a sliding mode control, typically you need a bound of uncertainty, right? You need to know within what bound that uncertainty is likely to lie, and then you design a controller. That means some information about the uncertainty or disturbance is required a priori. If that information is incorrect, the performance of controller may not be satisfactory, right? And the last area is disturbance estimation and compensation. The idea in this area is, I may not be able to actually find how much a parameter of the system is going to change. I may not be in position to measure or estimate exactly what disturbance is acting on the system, but am I in position to estimate the effect of all these things on output? If I am in position to estimate that effect, the composite effect, then I am in position to counteract it, right? Here the goal is not to find how much, for example, the resistance of an armature winding is changing. Here the effort is not to find out how much the friction of the bearing is changing. Here the effort is to find out what is the net effect of all these phenomena on the output. If I can estimate that effect, assuming that I have some mathematical theory, algorithms to estimate that effect, then I am in position to compensate it. And that is what is disturbance estimation compensation. Let us give me a simple examples, high gain control, okay, which it is just a first order system. Almost each one of you will be able to appreciate it. The dynamics is y dot is equal to f of y plus u plus d. Right, first order dynamics, u is the input, d is the disturbance acting on the system, right? Objective is y to track y star. Okay, I want to design a controller which will make the output of the system, that is y, to track some reference history y star, right? So I am designing a control law u. You can easily see that if I use this control law, the tracking error dynamics, closed loop dynamics, takes form e dot plus ke is equal to minus d. This controller is based on a famous theory known as input-output linearization. Okay, but you don't have to worry about that theory. I have designed a controller ut is equal to something. When I substitute in the original system, I get the tracking error e dot plus ke is equal to minus d. What it basically means, if d is 0, e will go asymptotically to 0. Right? If the disturbance acting on the system is 0, then error, tracking error will go to 0 as time t tends to infinity, asymptotic, right? But if d is not 0, then error will not go to 0, it will settle to some steady state value, right? The steady state value is given by 1 by k, right? Now look at this expression. The steady state value of error is 1 by k. If I want the error to go to 0, what should be the value of k? Infinity. That means the loop gain has to be increased to infinity to ensure that error must go to 0, right? Now, the moment you start loop gain increasing, k is essentially a loop gain. The moment you start increasing its value, you are compromising on the stability part, right? And many times it may not be feasible because this k may be coming from some amplifier, for example. Now, amplifier cannot give you whatever output you want, not definitely infinity, right? So, those physical limitations, and apart from that, the eating of the stability margins will put constraint on how much error you are going to have at the end, okay? This is a typical case of high gain control. These are the simulation results. You can see that as I increase the value of k from 6, 20 and 100, as the value of k is increased, the output is getting closer and closer to its reference value as expected. Theoretically speaking, when k is equal to infinity, the y will be exactly equal to y star. But this graph tells you that as you increase k from 6 to 20 to 100, the output error is reducing, tracking error is reducing, okay? High gain control. Integral control, right? Now, the control of earlier example has been added another term, which is basically integral term, okay? We are applying a proportional integral controller in simple words, right? The closed loop dynamic becomes E double dot plus Kp E dot plus Ki E is equal to minus D dot. So, here if D is equal to 0, E will go to 0 asymptotically. If D is constant, then also E will go to 0, because D dot will be 0 in that case. But if D dot is not 0, that happens for time varying system signals, for example, sinusoid. Okay. In that case, D dot will not be 0, and therefore, E will never be 0. Okay. The steady state value of E, for example, when D dot is equal to 1, that is, it is sort of a ramp signal, okay, will be 1 upon Ki. Now, again, it boils down, for constant disturbances, integral controller is a good option. But when it comes to time varying disturbances, the steady state error is decided by the integral gain. Again, you cannot increase it beyond certain value. Okay? So, integral controller can cater for, or if you are sure that the disturbances which are likely to occur are more or less not time varying, probably integral control is fine. But if you are not sure about it, and if your system is likely to be acted by time varying, fast varying disturbances, integral controller will not offer solution. These are the simulation results. At t is equal to 20, I am applying a sinusoid signal, 2 plus 2 sin t. Okay? So, at this point, I am applying a sinusoid signal, and here it is the output. You can see that output continues to oscillate about its reference value. It is not going to 0. It is oscillating in spite of an integral controller action being in present. That is the corresponding input. So, both of these examples have told you what we study in classical control, that high gain control by using a loop shaping, classical loop shaping, and integral kind of controls cannot address the issues of fast varying uncertainty. Now, I am going to introduce you extended state observer based control. I am going to talk about it later, but at present, this is what a controller I have designed by using ESO. With that, the error dynamics becomes like this, which basically tells you that E will go to 0 no matter what D is, provided D is estimated correctly. That is why the D cap term I have added. D cap is the estimate of D. If D is estimated accurately, that means D minus D cap it is 0, then I am estimating the disturbance and compensating it. Control has the element D cap, right? And therefore, the error dynamics will become E dot plus Ke is equal to 0, as if no disturbance is present, right? And these are the simulation results. You can see that the output actually at 20 seconds when the sinusoid disturbance acts, still the output is closely tracking to its reference value. This magic has taken place under the assumption that I am in position to estimate D. Okay. Can we do that? Are we in position to estimate this D? This D is a composite effect, parametric uncertainties, external disturbances, system nonlinearities, unmodeled dynamics, or whatever may be. Am I in position to do that? People have done a lot of work on this, and you will find these are the comparison results. High gain control, integral control, ESO based control, and this is what a disturbance estimation graph. We will talk about it more, but these three graphs, if you see, you will find that the ESO based control has offered you know, acceptable solution, not high gain or integral control. Okay. So, what is disturbance estimation and compensation? The idea is not new. It has been implemented in classical classical structure as well. You look at this block diagram. This D is acting at the input of this plant PS. What people have done is, they have taken the inverse of this plant, considering some nominal model for the plant, and then subtracted the input to get an estimate of this D. U0 is actually estimate of D, but just to cater for the improperness of this thing, another filter is introduced, and actually this is the estimate of D. This estimate then is subtracted from UA to, you know, to cancel the effect. This is a classical disturbance observer. This work started long time back, I mean almost like 30-40 years back. Okay. But then with this idea, people have evolved many different theories. I was introduced to this problem with one very interesting, when we were working on a missile guidance. Okay. Now, this problem you can always correlate with underwater vehicle also. What is missile in air, torpedo is in inside water. Okay. Missile is fired against a target in air. Similarly, a torpedo is fired underwater against a target, right. In this case, the issue was that this is a dynamic, your pointer, yeah. This is a missile and this is a target. You do not have to go through this mathematics, but what I want to tell you is, objective is this missile should hit this target, and therefore, the commanded acceleration on this missile to change its flight path appropriately is obtained by what is known as very famous guidance law known as proportional navigation guidance. Okay. This proportional navigation guidance is used for torpedoes as well. Okay. So, if you want to correlate this with underwater systems, you imagine that this is your torpedo and this is your target, okay, inside water. This is the proportional navigation guidance law. This guidance law have shown very good results for targets which are not maneuvering. That means, they are not changing their flight path very drastically. Probably more than 90% of tactical missiles use this simple formulation called proportional navigation. But if the target maneuvers, if target acceleration, lateral acceleration of target exists, and if it is fast varying, this proportional navigation guidance law have shown poorer performance. So, what people did? They started working on modifying the proportional navigation guidance law to cater for maneuvering targets. These are the some formulations I have listed here. We have worked on some of this formulation, and especially the last one. Here you can see the guidance law is modified significantly, and it contains a term called AT cos of gamma t minus theta. AT is the target acceleration. All these guidance law, what is common is, each one of these guidance law requires AT cos of gamma t. That means, you are supposed to know what is the target acceleration. Now, that is one quantity which missile or torpedo cannot have. They have onboard sensors, seekers, okay. They can measure range from the target, they can measure the bearings, azimuth elevation kind of thing, but they cannot measure directly the target acceleration. Okay. Then the issue was, how do we know if I want to implement this on actual missile, from where I will get the information of target acceleration? Then people started thinking on that, how to get this. We worked on this line. This was my motivating example, why I was introduced to this area. We started thinking that, can we consider this AT cos of gamma t minus theta sort of a disturbance acting on this system, and can we estimate that disturbance? Rather than calling as a target acceleration, I am saying that it is sort of unknown disturbance acting on this system. Then am I in position to estimate it? And if I can estimate it, then I am actually doing my job. That is where we started working on this problem. We use at that time delay control. I will not go in much detail, but this approach allows you to estimate the disturbance. Okay. We use this, and then when we implement it, you can see that actually the height and range of missile and target, a precise engagement for highly maneuvering target was possible. Okay. The target acceleration which we could not measure, by considering it as sort of a disturbance acting on that system, we estimated it by using a technique known as time delay control, and we found that it works. Okay. Then onwards, I have worked quite a bit in this area. and some of the results I will be showing you as the lecture progresses. But the idea is this: variety of techniques are available, disturbance estimation and compensation, large number of approaches are available. Many of them I have worked, and many of them I have not even worked. Unknown input observer, these are all keywords. If you search in IEEE or any other academic portal, you will get a large number of papers. Equivalent input disturbance method, disturbance observer, perturbation observer, time delay control, uncertain disturbance estimation, predictive filtering, sliding mode state and perturbation observer, and extended state observer. This is not a complete list, this is just a representative. Each one of them represents a theory itself. So I am going to talk to you about this last fellow, extended state observer. I will try to introduce you with simple examples, and I hope it will be useful to at least those who are likely to work in similar area. Extended state observer estimates the effect of uncertain disturbances along with the states. As the name suggests, extended state observer deals with extended order system. What we do? We have a dynamics of the system, say if it is third order, and that system is affected by disturbance, we consider disturbance as additional state, and therefore what we get is extended order system. An observer designed for that extended order system is known as extended state observer, right? The total disturbance is treated as extended state to be observed, and you will see that it is relatively independent of mathematical model, because that D is all encompassing. Let us look at a simple second order system. Y double dot, this may be a nonlinear function of its argument. I am considering this A is not known to me at all. This A is not at all. You can consider this as a DC motor, DC armature control motor dynamics, for example, if you neglect the inductance. It will also be, I think, second order dynamics, right? So, this A, I am considering that it is not known to me, and B is, its best estimate is B0, that is known to me. So, all these uncertainties I am clubbing as D. And so y double dot I am writing d plus b 0 u, right? D is unknown to me. It consists of unmodeled dynamics, unknown dynamics, it consists of external disturbances, uncertainties, and so on. I design a control following a simple input-output linearization. If you take this control law, you will find that, and if you define the tracking error as y star minus y, the tracking error dynamics becomes this, perfectly acceptable. But the point here is, this U needs knowledge of D. If you do not have knowledge of D, then this controller is not implementable, right? If you want to implement this controller actually, you need what is D, Then the issue is how we get it. That is where we use ESO. So this is a system dynamics. I consider D as an extended state. This is the original state space model, and by considering D as third state, this becomes an extended order system. The disturbance has been taken as an extended state. So, original system was second order. With this extended state, it becomes an extended order system. We deal with this system. This is the extended state observer, which is actually a nonlinear observer. The GI, G1, G2, G3, they are actually nonlinear function of E01. E01 is the error between y minus y cap or x1 minus x1 cap. You can see that this nonlinear gain function, very widely accepted nonlinear gain function, is something like this. It takes this form, and once you design alpha i's, deltas, and betas, this observer is ready for implementation. Simulations will show you that this works. By estimating the states x1, x2, x3, x3 is an estimate of D. So not only the plant states, but you are also estimating the disturbance. So, by using that ESO estimation, this was your original control strategy, which you were unable to implement because D was unknown. By using a ESO, I have made it implementable, because now x3 cap I am using. x3 cap is an estimate of D, and therefore it is implementable. This gain function GI, which are nonlinear function of their argument, they are nonlinear gain function. But a specific case arises, if you consider, this GI is equal to E01 itself. This happens when alpha I are taken as unities, and in that case it becomes actually a linear extended state observer. It becomes sort of a Leuenberger observer designed for an extended order system. linear dynamics. So in that case, the extended order system can be written as a state space model, where the extended order states are x1, x2, x3, other matrices are obviously defined, and then we design this for linear. We design extended state observer by following a Leuenberger observer theory, and you can see that the observer error dynamics can be shown like this. It is driven by h. H is actually rate of change of uncertainty or disturbance. Okay. This is a plant dynamics. You can easily prove the closed loop stability under this ESO. This is the plant dynamics corresponding state space model, original system dynamics, second order. So, with some mathematical manipulations, we can show that the state tracking error dynamics become something like this, and at the end, the overall controller observer error dynamics. EC is the state tracking error, and U is the observer state estimation error. The overall closed loop dynamics takes shape like this. It is very clear that this is a block triangular system matrix is in block triangular form, and therefore the eigenvalues of system matrix are union of eigenvalues of AS minus BS KS and AE minus LC. You can also see that since these systems are controllable and observable, you are in position to choose KS and L appropriately to place the poles as per your requirements. Okay. And so you can assure stability for the controller observer structure. You have to see that this error dynamics is driven by H. H is rate of change of disturbance. So, here also the issue comes, if H is not 0, if H will be 0 when D dot is 0, that means D is constant. If D is constant, it has asymptotic stability, but if D is not constant, if it is time varying, then this error dynamics is not asymptotically stable. It is bounded input, bounded output stability, you can say, assuming that H is bounded one. Okay. Of course, we have found solutions for this also. I will talk about it later. If the disturbance is not constant, but it is time varying, there are solutions for that. Okay. And the advancements in the extended state observer to cater these situations, I will tell you little later. Higher order ESO comes into picture. In fact, this slide is immediately. When H is not 0, when H is not 0, it is addressed by using what is known as higher order ESO. What is higher order ESO? Higher order ESO is you are appending the states not only one state. Suppose you have disturbance, and if the D dot is not 0, but rth derivative of D is 0, that typically happens for disturbances which can be represented in time polynomial form. So, D dot may not be 0, but rth derivative of D, if it is 0, then you can have a extended order system with R as additional states, number of additional states you put. Okay. That is decided by the order R at which the rate of change of disturbance is 0 or small, and then this becomes a general order, higher order ESO. If you design, then following the similar theory, if design extended state observer for this dynamics, you will find that the no matter how the D is varying, it offers you a solution. Okay. This is a one development, higher order ESO. This is a time polynomial form of disturbance. Like if you are in position to represent D as time polynomial like this, D0 plus D1T plus D2 square T square and so on. Typically, your disturbances like step, ramp, acceleration, they come in this picture. Okay. Many practical disturbances also can come in this. After all, when you talk about a physical system, the disturbances cannot be mathematical signals. They are also physical signals only, right? So, how fast they are varying? One important signal is sinusoid. We have done some work on this. I will be able to show you. Okay. So far, the extended state observer framework what you have seen. Typically, you need it to be in a controllable canonical form. That is, x1 dot is equal to x2, x2 dot is equal to x3, and the uncertainties and disturbances, they must appear in the last equation. Okay. A typical controllable canonical form kind of system. People have worked on it, because not every system will have that structure, right? mechanical systems, for example, spring mass damper system, if you take, you can write it x 1 dot is equal to x 2, x 2 dot is equal to something, right? Motion control systems probably mostly come in similar forms, okay? But then there are many practical systems where you will not be able to write them in controllable canonical form. Can we use ESO if the system is not that in that form? There is a development called generalized ESO. Such uncertainties are known as mismatch uncertainties, okay? System which is not in controllable canonical form, and when the uncertainties or disturbances are mismatched, we can use what is known as generalized ESO, okay? Look at this dynamics. X 1 dot is equal to, it is not x 1 dot is equal to x 2, it is something else. So, this dynamics is not in controllable canonical form, right? One. Second thing, you will find that the D and U are not appearing in the same channel. D appears in the first equation, whereas U appears in the second equation. So, the matching condition is not satisfied. What it basically means? The conventional ESO cannot be used, because conventional ESO requires dynamics to be in controllable canonical form and the uncertainties to be matched. They should appear in the same channel of U. So, people have worked on it and they came up with what is known as generalized ESO. We are in position to design a generalized ESO for such system and get the estimate of D. So, this is a brief theory of a generalized ESO. I will not go in much details, but I may need some more measurements in this case. This is a measured signal and this is the controlled signal, and then you define the disturbances as extended states. You get extended order system. There is a procedure how to go about it, and finally you get a generalized ESO, okay? Generalized extended state observer, okay? Which you can use for systems which are not in controllable canonical form and which have mismatch uncertainties. Okay. This is one development in this area. Now, I will talk to you about one example which we have not only theoretically done, but also practically implemented. These are typically what you call as a flexible joint system. Okay. Flexible joint system, you know, robotic arms. If the joint is assumed to be flexible, the dynamics becomes twofold, right? Rigid one link robotic manipulator has dynamics of second order. Flexible joint, it becomes fourth order. Flexibility at joint introduces or doubles the, you know, order of the system. So, this is the dynamics, this is a motor inertia, this is a load, and this is the flexibility effect is taken care by introducing a torsional spring, okay? If the joint is rigid, the torsional spring will not be there, okay? In that case, it becomes a rigid link robotic manipulator. The mathematical model can be shown as like this. You can see that it is fourth order in comparison to, you know, rigid link model, which is second order for one link. I am writing this in terms of you know, physical state variables. This is a state space model, you can say. Objective is the q 1 star minus q 1 to go to 0. That is, the link position, robotic angular position, should track some reference trajectory. So, we need to design a controller for this system. Now, if you look at this, this dynamics is not in controllable canonical form, right? This dynamics is not in controllable canonical form, and also the uncertainty, suppose if I assume that m, g, l, I, if they are uncertain, then the uncertainties will occur in the second equation, whereas the control appears in fourth equation. So, the conditions of traditional ESO are not satisfied by these dynamics. Instead of using generalized ESO, here we have applied some different techniques. We have done a coordinate transformation, what we call as a nonlinear coordinate transformation, to convert this original nonlinear dynamics from non-controllable form into a controllable form. Okay. So I define a new state variable. You are familiar with the state coordinate transformation, right? Similarity transformation, what we call. If I have a state space model x dot is equal to x plus bu, I can choose a non-singular t, a transformation matrix, which transform the states from x to z. Z is given by something like t into x, right? That is a coordinate transformation for linear systems. Similar concept is for nonlinear system, okay? Only thing is, it is actually a nonlinear coordinate transformation, okay? So, I have not given you the theory behind that, but I am telling you that the new states are defined in this manner. When you define new states like this, the new system in the new coordinates comes in this form, and you can see that this is now in controllable canonical form. After applying nonlinear coordinate transformation, the original mismatch uncertainty non-controllable form state space model has been converted into a controllable match uncertainty system, right. Now, I am in position to design ESO for this and ESO based controller for this, right. So, that is what we have done. This is the state space model. I am assuming the A, complete A as uncertain. Remember that the value of A is something like this. It takes into account so many system parameters. So, the complete A has been taken as uncertain or not known to me, just to show the effectiveness. If you know something, you can always keep it, and the remaining thing you can make as part of disturbance. But this is the worst case. You are saying that I do not know anything, right. So, this is now by defining this D as an extended state, in this case 5, the extended order system takes form like this. This is a nonlinear extended state observer, and the corresponding the controller design based on the input output linearization takes this form. You can see that z 5 cap I am using here. Z 5 is an estimate of the uncertainties and disturbances, right. This z 5 cap is estimated by the ESO. So, I am in position to implement this controller because ESO gives me the estimate of the unknown. This is a numerical data, controller gains based on time constant of 0.35, observer time constant is 1/3 of controller time constant. That means, observer bandwidth is 3 times more than the controller bandwidth, initial condition and all those things. Reference trajectory is taken as 30 sin t, and these are the simulation results. Z1 and its estimate, you the first figure tells you tracking performance as well as estimation performance. Reference trajectory is plotted along with the actual trajectory, and you can see that the controller has precisely tracked the reference trajectory, right. This figure and this figure tells you the estimation performance of ESO. Here second state and its estimate is plotted, third state and its estimate, fourth state and its estimate. This is a disturbance estimation, and you can see that the ESO has estimated the uncertainty disturbances very well, okay. And that is the reason why it is tracking nicely. If it does not estimate, then obviously there is no question of tracking it, because I assume the whole A is unknown, right. This is the control input. Look at the features of this design. There are many work appeared in literature where controllers are designed for flexible joint system, okay. How our work differ from the literature work? That is, it is a robust because it does not need accurate mathematical model. In fact, we assume A to be unknown completely. It does not know a mathematical model, only one sensor. This was an additional advantage. Traditionally, the flexible joint robotic controllers require link position and link velocity as well as motor position and motor velocity to be available to control, right. In our case, we needed only the link position measurement alone. All other measurements were obtained as estimates, okay, and we use those estimates. So, the number of sensors required from 4 to 1, and that is the reason IEEE transaction on industrial electronics accepted our work, because there was novelty from this point of view. Okay. It is practically viable because we have implemented on practical system, as I will show you, and it is straightforward to implement. If you look at it, the controller is not at all computationally intensive, it is straightforward. Experimental result, we have implemented it on a concert set, I think. Almost every one of you must be familiar with the word Quanser. Quanser is Canada's quite famous company, which have come up with a large number of sets where you can test your controllers, variety of systems. Okay. One set is flexible joint system. It is actually SRV0 to plant and link, and the flexibility is introduced by attaching these two springs. Okay. This is a general setup in from our control lab. A power amplifier, there is a Quark C Wincon software, okay. Then there is a data acquisition board, and so many. They come, it is a like a modular system by Quanser. Okay. We have 3-4 sets like this. So, these are the experimental results. Exactly the same reference trajectory was given, 30 sin t, and you can see that experimentally also it track, and ESO based controller was implemented. Okay. These are the estimated uncertainty. You can see that simulation we did not consider as measurement noise, but when it comes to practical system, measurement noise is present, right, and it started showing its effect. and this is the control input. Okay. What I wanted to tell you is, this technique is simple to implement, it is robust, and we have implemented it not only on this platform, some number of other platforms. Okay. I don't want to give you for different platforms, but internationally also, there are many results, papers, where people have shown that it works very well on practical systems. Now, coming to the part, some more results and applications. Okay. We have done quite a bit work on this ESO based control system, and some more results I would like to share with you, just to tell you the power of this approach. Since my background is on aerospace, typically we work on missiles, aircraft, launch vehicles, interplanetary vehicles, satellite, helicopters, and those kind of areas. Okay. So, my examples also will be little bit related to that. This is a roller topolet of a missile, tactical missile. Okay. What normally happens is, a missile, it is like this stick. Okay. But when aerodynamic loads acts on it, it has a torsional flexibility also. More longer the missile, you will find there is a torsional flexibility. Longitudinal flexibility is one part, but torsional flexibility also exists. Roll autopilot deals with controlling the motion of missile about its longitudinal axis, x axis. Okay. Traditionally, what people do is, the flexibility effect, torsional flexibility effect is ignored. They design controller assuming the missile to be rigid body, something like, if you look at the robotic arm, you design a controller assuming that it is a rigid link model, no joint flexibility, but apply it to a system where joint flexibility exists. There is no guarantee your controller will work. It depends upon how much is dominant your joint flexibility, right. Similarly, here people design assuming the missile dynamics to be rigid, but in practice they have to apply it for when the flexibility effect comes into picture. We have shown that the flexibility, people have designed LQR controllers for this kind of systems, and we have shown that when you introduce flexibility, that controller goes unstable. Whereas that controller is designed assuming the missile to be rigid, right? And then we provided a solution which caters for this flexibility dynamics. Now, this effect is not directly catered. The effect of this is being estimated by ESO and compensated. These are the results. You can see that we want roll angle to remain 0 whenever disturbance acts on the missile. This is our design, and these are existing 4-5 designs. And we have shown that in comparison with existing design, the ESO based design offers far better results compared to the others. Okay. This is one practical example. In fact, this approach is being tried for practical live missile at DRDL Hyderabad, Defense Research Development Laboratory Hyderabad, a laboratory which is primarily working for design and development of missiles. One theoretical problem which we addressed, which I think you will also agree, that frequently what we do is, if I have a nonlinear dynamics, we linearize it, right? We use Jacobian linearization to linearize the dynamics. Then we get transfer functions or linear state space models and so on. Then use linear control techniques to design controllers. That is the standard approach. If you have nonlinear dynamics, you have two approaches. Either go for nonlinear control design or linearize the nonlinear dynamics and apply linear control techniques. Directly to nonlinear systems, you cannot apply your classical control, for example. You don't have transfer functions, you don't have root Hurwitz criteria, root locus, Bode plots and so on, right? So, if you want to use linear control techniques, you have to linearize it. Okay. When you linearize it, what essentially you do is, you expand the dynamics in Taylor series about some operating point. So, when you look at the Taylor series, if you retain only the first order Taylor series terms, the dynamics is linear. The moment you take second order term, the squares comes into picture, and then the dynamics becomes nonlinear. So, that is the basis. You retain the first order term in Taylor series expansion and ignore all others. Okay. That gives you a linearized dynamics. Okay. What is more familiar known as Jacobian linearization. The issue is, this linearization, you do it about a particular operating point. this linearization is done about a particular operating point or equilibrium, whatever you call. If your system happens to depart from that equilibrium point substantially, that linearization is not valid, because then the higher order term starts coming into picture, right. If you happen to use a controller which is designed based on that linearized model for a system which is violating this condition, basic condition, then it is not likely to work. Okay. We thought, can we consider the effects of higher order terms which are ignored while linearizing as a sort of disturbances acting on the system? We have ignored, normally people ignore it. What we say that we are not going to ignore it. But we consider those effects as if an external disturbance is acting on the system. If we think that way, and then can we estimate it? If you can estimate it, you are virtually making that linear controller to be operational for no matter what is your operating condition. Because the terms which are likely to create problems, you are estimating them and you are compensating. That idea we implemented for a single system, and that is where the title is Extending Operational Range of Linear Controllers. Now, for your traditional examples like control of electrical motors and other things, this picture, this situation may not come. But when it comes to, for example, missile, aircraft, or for that matter, underwater vehicles, the dynamic changes drastically. Tactical missiles, when you launch, their lifespan is seconds, right? At time t is equal to 0, their mass is, say, 500 kg. At time is equal to 5 seconds, their mass reduces to 100 kg. In span of 2-3 seconds, the mass reduces by 400 kg and the moment of inertia is accordingly they reduce. Those are system parameters. System parameters are changing and they are changing drastically. So, if you linearize the dynamics at time of launch, do you think the linearized dynamics